All right. The purpose of this interview is to document the experiences of Staff Sergeant Albert Al Gibson during his time serving in the United States Air Force in the Korean War. Our themes for the interview will include life before the war, basic training, the war itself, and post-war life. I am the interviewer. My name is Nathan Allgood. My partner in this project is Keon Butler. Also in the room listening to us today is journalism instructor Jeffrey Hope and video instructor Steve Vachon. Izzy Bouchard, Dylan LeClair, and Patrik Orcutt is shooting the video of our interview. We are also joined by students Kristen Ackley, Brianna Breeze, Christopher Brownell, Nathan Cram, David Furtado, and Zachary Hunes. We also have Jim Neville, the director of the Cole Land Transportation Museum. Mr. Gibson, thank you for doing this interview. Would you please state your name, your date of birth, and where you're from?
Yeah, my name is Albert A. Gibson, and my date of birth is February 24th, 1932.
And where are you from?
I'm originally from, now I live in Maine, but originally from New Jersey. Ventnor, New Jersey. It's just a suburb of Atlantic City, New Jersey.
Okay. And where did you move to in Maine before growing up?
That'll come about actually on the veteran interview as we go along, because I after I joined the military, I never really went back to New Jersey to live.
So it was from New Jersey that you enlisted?
I enlisted in the service from New Jersey, yes.
Okay. And so in the town where you grew up, was the people aware of the growing conflict in Korea before it actually started?
I don't think so. I don't think a lot of the people in the States were aware of what was really happening until eventually the North Korea invaded South Korea.
So it was probably a bit of a royal small town. You grew up here?
No, it's not too small. It's really a resort town.
Okay. So, from the town, was there any friends or relatives that also enlisted when you did?
Yeah, I had a couple of my high school friends that enlisted at the same time.
Okay. And so what was it that made you decide to enlist?
Well, there was a couple things. I was enrolled to go into the university in New Jersey, but I was going to be drafted. My number come up, so I thought that rather than wait and be drafted, I'd enlist.
Right. And were your friends and family supportive of this decision?
Yes.
And so you're just probably eager to explore part of the world, even during wartime?
Well, my mother wasn't too happy about it, but she eventually agreed that, you know, it would be okay.
And you were able to keep in contact with them?
Oh, yeah.
Mails and stuff?
Yeah, regular communications with them.
Was there anything that you brought with you from home when you went to basic?
No, just my physical self.
Right, okay. And where did you go for basic training?
Well, at that time, they were recruiting a lot of people, and there was two camps at that time. One was down in San Antonio in Texas, and I went to Sampson Air Force Base in New York.
Was there anything at your time in basic that always stuck with you?
Well, not really. A lot of drilling and, you know, education of the military, of what was expected of you, and going out on hikes and firing line. So it's the basics of any normal basic training, I guess.
So when you was doing this training, I remember you said you had some friends that enlisted. Were they also with you in basic, or did they get?
No, we were all split up. I never did have any friends. Hometown friends in the basic training with me.
Was you ever able to get in contact with them during your time?
No. Basically made new friends in basic training.
And so is it, when you became the forward observer after the training, was it assigned to you, or did you get to?
Now, after basic training, they sent me down to Texas to a training school down there, which was actually a civilian college, and I was being trained to be a ground power equipment operator, maintenance person. And so basically,
So was there, there's probably some special training then?
Yes, it was. And what the basic what the training was back then was to maintain the units that would start jet aircraft and maintain power to them on the ground and also power for lights and so forth.
So was you stationed anywhere stateside before Korea?
I was stationed at that civilian college, and then I went to Francis E. Warren base in Wyoming, and I was supposed to receive more training there, but my tour got cut short. They told me after I was there for a month that I was going to go to Korea.
So about a month after basic is when you shipped out?
After I had that initial training in basic, then I went to Texas for, I was there for a couple months, and then Wyoming, and then I was told I was going to Korea.
So when they sent you to Korea, that's when they assigned you as the forward observer?
Not until I got there.
Not until you got there?
Yep.
So where did you go first when you got to Korea?
Well, actually, we boarded a troop ship in San Francisco and sailed to Yokohama, Japan.
Okay.
And from Japan, we took a troop train down to the southern end of the island, and from there, we flew over in military aircraft to Korea. So I get to Korea at the end of January, 1952.
Okay. So was you in Japan for?
Just long enough to take the train ride to get to the base to fly over to Korea.
So not much time at all?
No, not then, no.
Was there any, could you feel like emotions or tensions in the fellow soldiers around you on the transportation rides towards Korea?
Little anxiety, maybe, but not much tension.
Overall, it was good morale.
Yeah,
you can tell. So once you when you was traveling to Korea, and you didn't bring anything with you from home to give you memories or something back home?
No, just a few pictures, maybe.
A couple
pictures.
Basically,
that was it.
Yeah. Just of your family?
Yeah.
Okay. And so once you arrived into the country, that's when they said forward observer for you?
Well, I was assigned to what they call the 6th or 7th AC&W squadron, which is a aircraft control and warning squadron under the 502nd Tactical Air Command. And when I got there, they told me that they needed some help up front with the forward observer team.
So what would you say would be the basic roles of a forward observer?
Well, basically it was a five-man team, and we had two officers and three enlisted men that went up to the site where we were going to perform our duties.
Right.
And we would do a lot of spotting and map coordinations, and then we would give it to the officers. One of them is usually a flying officer and would do most of the communications with the aircraft that we were calling in for support.
Okay, so you was the guy on the radio then?
Somewhat. I was mostly a spotter.
Just a spotter.
To give the information and map coordinates to pass them along.
So what was the terrain like in the country?
Oh, very hilly. Yeah.
Lots of hills. So what was your feelings like once you arrived in Korea? Anxious? Nervous?
Well, it was a little unexpected, to the point that the country itself was pretty well torn up from the war. And a lot of the people were more or less not formally educated. And so it was a different culture than you're used to at home, you know. We're in the States.
So you said you had to do a lot of climbing for the hills to be able to spot?
Yeah, well, usually we had one position that we would go to, designated position, and where we could oversee the main line of resistance, and that's where we would work from.
So was you ever worried about the enemy advancing on your position?
All the time, yeah.
All the time. Did you ever have to pull back to avoid enemy contact?
Yes, we did, yeah.
And so was there any close quarters battle, like hand-to-hand combat?
Well, yeah, but mostly that was with the infantry. We would try to pull out before. We were a prime target because they knew we were calling in air support and or artillery support. So we tried to keep low key of our position and where we were.
Okay. So could you describe how the feeling was when you was spotting and coordinating these artillery strikes and being able to see what resulted from your calls?
Well, it's something that you don't forget, because when you called in some of these airstrikes, you know, and they used napalm a lot, and that was a horrific, when you'd see that piece dropped on troops or vehicles or whatever, it, you know, something that sticks in your mind.
Right. So how would they make sure not to strike their own units, friendly units?
Well, was one of the key parts of when you'd call in air support, that you gave them the correct coordinates on the map. And when they got low enough, basically they could see what they were supposed to target. And naturally, this was in good weather. You couldn't call in these strikes at night, basically, or in bad weather.
So
that's when we would call in the artillery strikes.
Just during the daytime?
Well, artillery, we'd call it in both day and night, or poor weather. And how we would keep the fire from our own troops was by usually calling in first a smoke round. We'd give them the coordinates where we wanted them to fire that one round, smoke round. Of course, when that happened, the enemy knew what was coming, you know, but same as us if we were on the receiving end. So where we'd see that smoke round, where it would fall, we'd correct their line of fire from there. And then when they got it right, they would open up regular firing.
So you probably had a couple of smoke rounds a lot more closer than you would like.
Yeah, sometimes they might be behind you or way beyond, you know, so it had to be corrected.
So when you was, since you was around the use of the radio, were there any voices or things you heard over the radio that was peculiar?
Yeah, the funny thing is we would hear Russians talking in the aircraft flying further up north, and you could hear them and the North Koreans and Chinese, but there were definitely Russian aircraft that we could hear the pilots talking.
So the voices of the Russians were very distinct on the radio?
Yeah, I didn't understand it, but we knew it was Russian, yeah.
Right. Did you ever, was your superior officers ever interested in the Russian pilots?
In what
did you have to report it to them that you what you heard? Or?
Well, no, they would hear it. Same thing.
Well.
And back at the at our headquarters, or the observation of this of the radar, they would hear that because they'd be directing aircraft up to the north for bombing raids and so forth.
They
would hear that quite frequently on the radio.
Was there any? Did you see any of the Russian fighter pilots, the planes?
I saw some MiGs, but they didn't hang around too long. Usually they'd make a pass, and then they were back up north. They weren't around the main line. They would, more or less, they were intercepting the bombers that were heading north to do the bombing raids.
Right. So you probably saw a few dogfights then, maybe?
Not really. They were really north of us. We did see some action, but not too much.
So how was the noise of the battle, of all the artillery strikes and stuff, was really loud explosions?
Oh yeah, yeah.
Would you say that they were pretty close by to you?
Close?
Yeah, the
too close.
Too close?
Yeah.
did it cause any damage to your hearing?
Yeah, that's where I lost some of my hearing, was from the artillery shells. So
what part of Korea? You said you just stayed in about one area. Do you remember?
Yeah, but back when I was there in 52, the MLR was pretty stable. And they were trying to, they knew there was going to be a peace coming soon. So the Chinese were trying to take more territory. So there'd be pushes now and then to take certain hills. And at that time they called it, when I was over there, the Battle of the Hills. You've probably heard some of the names like Pork Chop Hill and, you know, in okay. the history books, things like that. I was up in that area, up near the Chorwan Valley.
Chorwan Valley. So you was on Pork Chop Hill itself?
No, but I was in that area.
Okay.
Yep.
What does MLR stand for? I heard you say that. I'm not quite
Main
sure.
Line of Resistance.
Okay. So was there an how long would you be on duty for combat?
Okay, we'd go up. We were scheduled to go up there for around 15 days. Could be shorter or longer, then you'd be replaced by another team. Mm-hmm. So when we left the MLR, we'd go back to a point, actually ours was in a rest camp in close to Weejambu, a little village outside there. And so that wasn't too bad back there.
You got to do, how long would you get to rest for?
Probably around 10 days or so.
So on for 14, off for 10?
Yeah.
Okay. Was there any like materials or goods that you could trade with the other soldiers when using this?
Well, there wasn't much training because up when we were up at the front lines, mostly you were eating sea rations, and in the different breaks of the battle or whatsoever, they'd try to bring up hot food, especially around, you know, a Sunday or holidays, things like that. Mm-hmm. So. We would mostly have the sea rations, but wasn't much to trade. I wasn't a smoker, never smoked, so I would trade my cigarettes maybe for a can of peaches or chocolate bar or something like that, you know.
So you get just more food.
Yeah. Cigarettes.
Was there anything that you traded from the cigarettes, from the smokes that you was able to keep for a while, something like you maybe remember the most?
No, not really. Like I'd say, it's candy bar or something like that.
Okay.
When you're up there, you'd share and share alike whatever you had, you know.
So it was like a close-knit community.
Oh, very much, yeah. Yeah.
Was you able to keep in contact with any of your squad members after the war?
From some of my unit members, yeah, a good friend of mine. He was a wheat farmer out in Kansas, and old Melvin, and we kept in contact for a while.
Okay, so Melvin was part of the small group?
Right.
Okay. Do you guys still keep in touch to this day?
No, he's passed away.
Sorry to hear that. So what was it like then, returning home after the war?
Returning home?
Yes, sir.
Well, it was a little different. There was no reception when we sailed back from Japan to San Francisco. We on the ship took a couple weeks, and which was a long time trying, basically anticipating heading back to the States, but. There was no real reception as such. It was just when we got off the ship, we had lined up waiting for the trucks to pick us up with our equipment and take us to a demarcation point. And the Red Cross was there with coffee and donuts and an army band. That was about it.
So when did you find out that you was going to return home?
Well. It was a year. I knew I had a year of duty. Well, it was a couple of days before Christmas, and I was told that, you know, I'd be heading out 31st of December. We were flying out of Kimpo,
Okay.
That, which was near Seoul, over to Japan.
Do you remember the name of the ship that transported you from Japan back to the States?
Yeah, it was USS General Gordon.
General Gordon, okay. And so once you got back to the States, did you continue your service in the Air Force?
Yeah, I had 2.5 years left to serve.
2.5. And what were the jobs that you...
Well, when I first got back, seems like I was one that was always targeted for something other than my job. When I got to the base, actually, I was assigned to Presque Isle Air Force Base. And it was a fighter interceptor squadron up there, a small squadron at Presque Isle at the time. And Loring Air Force Base was further north, but I was on Presque Isle. And when I got there, I was supposed to go to my regular job as a power man. But they said, well, we need a military policeman. And I said, well, again, well, you know, that's not my MOS. And, you know, I wasn't too happy. And they said, well, that's where the needs are today. So I was there for about, maybe 8 months at that job, and finally got into my power unit that I should be.
What does MOS stand for?
That's your job title.
Okay. So, as your time as the military police, was there something you remember that's very distinct?
Oh, I remember quite a bit about that because it was a little interesting. A lot of the fellows hadn't served other except stateside. And one of the first job duties they gave me was base patrol, serving in a vehicle. And I'll never forget that it was a Sunday, quiet day, and not much activity on the base. And I was patrolling around, and I was up near the hospital area, and there's a restricted area for parking ambulances only. And so I drove up there, and there's a staff car parked there. And so I looked at it and I said, well, he's where he shouldn't be, so gave him a ticket. And turned out it was the base commander that I ticketed. So I heard about that the next day. But
yeah, he wasn't
it was a little funny on my part, but they didn't think it was.
So he wasn't too happy about the ticket?
Not really. He chewed out the provost marshal. So.
And where was this base at?
Presque Isle.
In Presque Isle?
Yeah.
Okay. So about after that, were there any other jobs that you were assigned before the end of your time?
No, I went from there. I went actually to my ground power job with the 528th Material Squadron on the base. So
okay.
I finally did get to serve what I was supposed to be doing.
And this was in Presque Isle as
yes.
well?
Yes. Okay.
So what came after Presque Isle, after once your time was done with the service?
Well, when I was in Presque Isle, there's a University of Maine.
Mm-hmm.
So I used to take night courses and to further my education. So when I got out of the service, I originally planned to go back to New Jersey, but they were looking for telephone people. They were hiring quite a few telephone people at the time up in the area. Mm-hmm. So I applied and got a job up with them.
Okay. So, well, doing a little reflection here, how did your experience in Korea change your outlook in life?
Well, I think, you know, when you see the action that we saw, it's one thing that I remember a lot about is the suffering of the people. They suffered as much, if not more, than the military did. They were abused over there. But quite harshly by the North Koreans and the Chinese when they were overrun, mm-hmm. the areas before I got there. And the area was really destroyed. The people were really destitute for food and homes and material. I remember we'd have kids come across from looking for safety, and the poor kids, they were basically starving. A lot of them, they had no parents. They had either lost them in the war or they were separated. And so we used to try to help the kids along back to the site where, you know, they'd be safe. And one thing I really sticks out in my memory is that the kids would come, of course they couldn't speak English, and we were very limited to what we knew in Korean, so they were hungry, and we'd give them some food, you know, a can of our peaches or whatever we had from our sea rations. One thing we gave them that they'd never seen before, which was amazing, just to go to show you what life was like, was a chocolate bar. If you hand them a Hershey bar, and they'd look at it, and they'd open it up and eat that, and their eyes would get big and round, and it's one of the first words they would learn in English was chocolate. So, but, you know, it's amazing. Here you are brought up here in the States, and all this is just normal. Right. And a chocolate bar, how that would really make that kid excited. It's something to see.
So you found ways to communicate with them regardless of the language barrier.
Yeah. Some of the, after a while, they'd learn English pretty good, be broken, but we'd be able to communicate with them.
And so would you see them, like, when you was out in combat on the hill?
Well, lots of times in the lull, they would be trying to sneak through, like you see in Syria, where all these refugees are trying to get through the line. You'd see long lines of them trying to be ahead of the enemy, trying to escape the enemy and heading into South Korea, carrying everything they did own, carrying it on their heads in big satchels, or very few animals, no vehicles as such. A few had a bicycle, they thought they were lucky, but other than that, they were looking to get to safety. They didn't want to stay in North Korea.
So they probably, were they worried about spies within the group coming in?
Well, they did in certain areas have problems with them, where a North Korean or Chinese soldier would dress as a refugee and they would have a weapon, grenades, rockets under their, you know, dress. So if they get behind you, you're in trouble. So you used to have to watch pretty close to who was coming through.
So was there like some kind of vetting process or?
No, not so to speak, not like you have today, no.
It's more of just keeping your eyes open?
Yeah, it was more or less trying to help them out and get to the safe areas.
So did that happen often? Was there a lot of reports of the spies?
Not really quite often, but you would see not real frequent, but you would have it come through, you know, a week, or sometimes if there was a big push, and they would come through in by the droves trying to get away.
So was you able to make any friends with the locals?
Not really. I was too busy doing other things, really, to make any friends with them. We did at times, we would associate, you know, it was a United Nations war. So we had quite a few other troops over there from, well, we had Turkish, we had Canadians, Australians, and, you know, sometimes funny things would happen because we were, one night we went over to visit with some Australian troops, and one of my buddies went over with us, and they always had a little ration of beer, you know, that they would have, and so my buddy had one and a couple, and it was not too much, but, you know, he got talking, and he kept calling them limeys. Well, they don't like that term, you know, the Australians. They're not limeys, so he would call them limeys, and pretty soon one of them said, listen, he said, you know, you call us limeys again, there's going to be a little war of our own here. So I got him out of there quick, yeah. So we didn't hang around too long.
But overall, you would say even all these people from different parts of the world was able to come together and be friends.
Yeah. Well, there was quite a few different. Like I said, we interfaced with Canadians, even the Turks. One thing about the Turkish guys, they were pretty good because at nighttime, they would volunteer to go out on patrol and keep our soldiers behind. You know, they loved to go out on night patrol and. made the guys that normally would go out happy that, well, they could stay behind. They didn't have to go out with them.
All right, get a chance to rest. So looking back on your years in the service, what are your thoughts about the time you served?
Well, I'm not sorry. You know, it's funny because a lot of people don't realize they thought that the Korean War never gained anything. But I've had a couple examples different from that, because we did save South Korea from being a country today with North Korea, and look what North Korea is like today. Well, I was down visiting my daughter once in Georgia, and my son-in-law had to go to the tailor's to get some pants shortened. So I went along with him, and behind the counter was this fellow, and I recognized him as he sure looked Korean to me. So I said to him, do you mind me asking you if you're Korean? He said, yes, I am. Why do you ask? And I said, well, I served over in Korea. And he asked me why, when? And I said, 1952. So he looked at me and he walked around from the counter and held his hand out. He says, I want to thank you for saving my country. Well, look, that hit home when that happened. And I've heard that from a couple other Korean people right here in Bangor that would say that. So I think, yes, we did good, and it made me feel proud that I was part of that.
So like a high level of respect.
Yes.
The Koreans.
The Koreans today, because they still, like the Korean book, the awards they give the Koreans, they have, I have never gone back to Korea, but they do have tours that they will treat the veterans back to Korea for a short week tour in appreciation of their service.
So what would be your thoughts about the military service today and now?
In what respect? I respect the military wholeheartedly, and I support the military.
So do you feel that everyone should serve at least some time in the military?
Well, that's quite controversial, but yes, I do. I think that a short term in the military would hurt no one, and it would help. Military, they're disciplined to the point that you do learn respect and of your country, your fellow man, and even your overseas people. It's there for you to respect, and I think it's a good learning process.
Okay. So it gives you a sense of like appreciating more of your surroundings.
Oh, definitely appreciate what we have in this country. Mm-hmm. We're very fortunate to live in this country. It's a free country, and even when you see the protesting and some of the violent protesting and all, it's the right of the citizen, even though some of it you might think is wrong, and some of it is wrong, but they have that right.
So are there any questions that no one has ever asked you that you would like to answer?
No, I don't think so. When we do the interviews with the school children, they can come up with some pretty good questions, and they're very interesting, and I really like working with them, because it's an education that they do not get in school. And that part of history of the military and an individual service in the military is really lost in history, I think. I had quite a few relatives in World War II, and I used to talk with them and learn a little of history. But I don't think that today's world, this is really happening in some areas. That's why I think we're fortunate in this area here, or even in the state of Maine, that we have this program with the Coal Museum, where they bring the children in from far north as Fort Canton down to Kittery. They come in and interview all different branches of service, all different veterans from different wars. And it gives them a perspective of what life is like. And I think that even the teachers that are involved with the students really appreciate it, because they tell us, they thank us for our service, but they say what you guys are doing is really helpful for these students.
So going back to the kids, what were some of the interesting questions that they would ask you?
Well, they would ask you questions of what did you do in the military? How did you like it? What foods did you eat? Basically, what was your main job? And where did you come from? Where was your home? And what life was like? You know, they were very interested in what you really did in basic training and then what you did in the military after basic training.
And these are the schools in Maine?
They're schools in Maine, yeah.
Okay.
Usually it's seventh grade up through high school.
And you still do this to this day?
Yes. Yeah, we have the program. It's a good program, like I say. We have a session in the spring and a session in the fall. It starts in May 1st and basically ends Veterans Day.
Okay. Did they seem interested in serving the kids from your stories that you would tell?
Well, a lot of the kids, you get so many that I usually talk to them also on what their ambitions are in life and what are they going to do after they get out of high school. Very interested. And some of them have pretty good heads on their shoulders, and some kids have no idea what they're going to do. Some of them are already made up their mind that they're going to go into the military or go to college or just go out and get a job. So
you feel that by telling your story, it kind of helps give them a sense of direction?
I feel that way. Yes, mm-hmm. I do.
That's good. Well, Mr. Gibson, on behalf of my partner and myself, we would like to thank you so much for your service and allowing us to interview you today.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.